read on the OpenWRT mailing list that they want to drop support, and a lot of communities want to drop support for these devices. And I think they are still good enough to not go to the trash bin. And especially in Weimar, we have the problem, we have like 80% of our devices are like these 4 megabyte TP-Links. So how can we like give some live support? There are good reasons against them, because like they can't do 5 gigahertz, and that's difficult in dense areas with a lot of noise. But they are like really expensive, inexpensive, and they are reliable. So I have some before talking, there are some basics that I think we have to do earlier or later if we want to keep support. And this is like dropping support for Lucy. If you don't know Lucy, this is like a Lua-based CGI scripting web interface that runs on the device. And it's, I think it's also impossible to have like support for the package manager, that's OPKG. And we also have to drop debugging symbols just because they are like taking too much space. And the approach to use these devices would be to use the image builder functionality of OpenWRT and to build custom images for these 4 megabyte devices. And for having a web interface, like I would propose to use UBAS and RPCD and keep the web interface outside of the device. So what's the problem? We have like 4 megabytes, and on a typical device, that's like the kernel, 1.2 megabytes, and the compressed SquashFS with the userland and some kernel modules occupies the rest of the device. And if there's free space, OpenWRT creates JFFS2, that's an compressed flash file system. Like there, the UCI configuration is stored. And our idea is to look on everything like kernel SquashFS where we can save some space. I've looked in the OpenWRT archive, and the 2.6 kernel was like 780 kilobytes compressed, and the current kernel is like 1,200 kilobytes, maybe even bigger. This is already the version from the new master target, ATH79. There are already good compression from the file system, and no debugging symbols, and no Wi-Fi modules included, because they are like loaded as external modules. So now you have like the problem, you have your firmware, it's too big, and you want to look where can I get some free space, or what options can I drop. You can look the symbols that are inside the kernel. There's a tool called NM, and there's an option to sort by size. And you can see like there are around 30,000 symbols that are inside the kernel, and this is from the tiny target. And you have some funky stuff in there, like there's EFI support, MS-DOS partition support, and there's also support for a new switch framework that is only supported on one single device from all devices inside the tiny target. However, if you switch this options off in the kernel config, you don't get a lot. This is like 10 or 20 kilobytes. So this is worth to look if there's some misconfiguration. And these are the basic OpenWRT options that are important for reducing the size of the kernel. The first one is config kernel k-awesomes. This drops the symbols from the kernel. That means if you have like a crash, you only get numbers and no function names. And if this is already dropped, you can also drop like the debugging info. And because we don't have OPG package manager, we can also strip the kernel exports. This means we can't load any external modules anymore, but we save some space this way. So with these options, you already get quite a good gain, like several hundreds kilobytes less kernel space. If you're like really desperate, I wouldn't recommend it, but you can also like disabling the logging from the kernel itself. There's called config kernel printk. But then when you type in dmask, you get like an empty output. So this is a last resort, but I've added it sometimes. You just need a quick hack. So now this is more or less not so serious. Yeah, I know. okay. Like if you are like have a community where you don't need this fancy stuff, you can also disable IPv6 or the new Mac like mesh protocol, like we in Weimar could do, because we are like run legacy stuff. It's just for the joke. Yeah, it's not. Don't do it. Yeah, actually, several people ask me this question, how to disable legacy IPv4 features. I'm not sure. You have to dig into the Linux kernel configuration and look if there's something you can drop. But like a general approach that's missing in OpenWRT at the moment, and a lot of embedded people are doing is like using link time optimization for the kernel. At the moment, the kernel uses the GCC functionality called GC sections that basically collects information while compiling and then uses this information to remove unused parts. And link time optimization is in a similar approach, but has a lot more information because it comes directly from the compiler. But there's no official upstream Linux support, but there's a patch set from an Intel developer. But I didn't manage it to get working on OpenWRT, but I'm confident that it will be possible. And there's if you like want to explore this route, there's an article in Linux Weekly News by Nicolas Pitre, and he got good numbers for compiling the kernel with link time optimization. And there's also if you manage to get LTO working, you can also like use this to trim symbols you don't need in your kernel configuration. And there he got like 29% reduction instead of 21 for GC sections. And if you have a 4 megabyte device, this would be more than 100 kilobytes. But in OpenWRT, it's difficult because the Wi-Fi drivers are from a backported kernel. And I just added it because I think it's a nice idea, but I didn't manage to get it working. So this is for the kernel. Now to the SquashFS. Like SquashFS is like a read-only compressed file system that is created when the image is created. And there are some options you can set that have impact on the final image size. Like the most important one is the block size. That means like the compression function gets 1 megabyte of data and can work better. You can tune that from 264 or even 64 kilobytes to 1 megabyte. But there's a big trade-off because when the device is running, this compressed data needs to be uncompressed in memory. So until a while ago, the default was like to keep 3 1-megabyte blocks in memory decompressed. That killed a lot of memory, up to 7-8 megabyte memory only for having the data in the memory. So you need also set the fragment cache size to 1. This makes like booting slower, but I think booting is not so important for mesh networks. And if you have space and low memory, you can also consider setting it very low to get more memory. Like if you have like the old 1043 or so TP-Link with 8 megabyte flash, you can get some more memory. I didn't test it, but I've read like if you only use JFFS2 instead of SquashFS, you even get more one-time memory. And you can check with proc mem info. There's mem available that's in newer kernels, like it's in LIDE 71, I think. You can, this is the amount of memory that is reclaimable from the kernel. Like this free and mem-free is not reliable. That lies to you, because it also counts kernel memory that you can't get back. So there's another idea. I think that's something with no trade-offs. You can sort all the files in your root system by similarity, and because more similar files compress better together. And there's even a nice small C implementation for doing this. It's called bin sort, and you can just hack it into the OpenWRT build system. I plan to do a patch, and I got on an image without any packages, I got 35 kilobytes, and I think if you like have a lot of stuff, you can get up to 100 kilobytes for free, basically. So this exploits that the compression algorithm works better with similar files. In the user land, you can also attempt everything that is compiled with C to activate link time optimization. It's not always a win. Some projects get increasing in size. Some are introducing strange bugs. I remember a while ago I attempted to compile EV as a wireless info with LTO, and all flags were missing. So something was reduced that shouldn't be. So be careful. But usually you get like at least 10 to 15 kilobytes on a bigger package. In OpenWRT, also the libc Moozle is not LTO'd at the moment. I think it should be possible. It's also something that is maybe happening in the future. So also the feed, additional packages in the feed, a lot of them are not even like having this GC sections optimization. So it's worth, if you really need the space, it's worth checking all this, that you reduce the size. If you still have a problem, you can attempt to modify BusyBox. There are tons of options for BusyBox, and at the moment there's a BZIP2 support that I guess nobody uses this. There's also the old ifconfig and route and mkswap stuff that's activated, and like help messages. Nobody reads them anyway. but if you have a 4MB device, you can disable them. But in my testing, there were not huge gains. So if you really switch off a lot of stuff, you might get a few kilobytes this way. Also, like an idea would be to use Toybox. This is the BusyBox alternative that's on a different license, not GPL. But there, the author writes that the shell that is included is not fully POSIX compliant, and you need like MKSH, and MKSH is big. It's like bigger as BusyBox, I think. So, but it's not that bad. I tried today using the OpenWRT master with a new ATH79 target with device tree and current kernel 4.14 to build an image with all the new fancy Freifunk mesh stuff. Like I added Babel, L3, WormD, distributed DSCP, even like 464 XLAT for like legacy IPv4, WireGuard and stuff like that, and also Mubus RPC Mubus stuff, like to call the stuff over HTTP. And the final image was only 3.2 megabytes, so you have 800 kilobytes for your custom stuff. That is, I think, is doable. So it's just the defaults. It's not it's without the hex I mentioned it before. So it's just like the SquashFS stuff. Okay, memory is also a problem. So the problem is the kernel is already decompressed in memory. So the bigger the kernel, the less memory you have. Then you have all these OpenWRT daemons running and all these routing protocols. There's one switch you can set, and that's for m min 3 kilobytes. This is the amount of memory that is reserved for kernel allocations. You can set it to 64 kilobytes because it was the old default in Chaos Calmer. It was raised by the OpenWRT guys because the newer devices with 5 gigahertz, they just need more memory for allocations, and our devices run with the setting without any problems, like for months or years at least. And the default is 1 megabyte, and this is my opinion. It's too much. If you are like really cool and run everything IPv6, you can just kick that contract stuff and disable network address translation. Because like the contract needs to keep every connection in memory, and this can like cost a lot of memory. I don't really know if the 32 megabytes are good enough for like having a lot of clients and connections. There are some settings for network buffers you can tune. I have no idea. So I think the defaults are not that bad. You can take a look with config kernel slab info. This adds some overhead, but then you have like in proc slab info have an overview about all caching data structures and kernel allocations, and you can see like, oh, contract is using all my memory and have a problem and stuff like that. So I've said no Lucy anymore, and let's do everything via Mubus. Mubus is like really like long time in OpenWRT. It's like their version of systemd to have like events, and daemons can call each other. And on the device, you can get a list and an overview of methods that you can call with all kinds of signatures. And there's support in procd, like for starting and stopping processes. You can get the list of clients in host APD. You can, I think, even kick clients and stuff like that. You can set UC values. You can scan for Wi-Fi networks and get a list of current Wi-Fi clients. And you can add your own interface via RPCD. And you can call Mubus over HTTP. Like there's a small mod called HTTP mod Mubus, and you can basically talk JSON RPC to Mubus, and you can do it from the browser or from curl or from whatever. JSON-RPC is pretty simple. It's like if you're familiar with REST APIs, it's like a different approach, but the whole interface in the browser is very, very similar. So if you want to add your own stuff to RPCD, you can write C, shared library, or you can use a shell script wrapper, and you can call your custom shell script with the parameters that RPCD gives the shell script. There are a lot of examples in the OpenWRT repository, and the basic idea is the router is just an RPC AP endpoint, and your client can be everywhere or everything. So you can set up a static website on GitHub and point the have an input for your router IP and talk to the device. You can also have, if you need it offline, there's a new fancy browser feature called Progressive Web Applications, where you can have an app locally cached on your device, so you don't even need internet to use it. I guess you can even build a mobile app also against this interface. So it's pretty powerful if you want to have your own customizations and still want to use it. And I think this is also a good way, not only for megabyte devices, but also for other devices, because if you have more flash, you can just add the JavaScript stuff and your on the device. But it's the same interface. So I think we have a lot of these devices, and I know there are good reasons against them, but I think they shouldn't be in the trash, and there are some use cases where they can be still useful. Okay, thank you. Yeah.